Good afternoon, and thank you for joining us. I'm Janice Brunner, Group General Counsel and Head of Civic Engagement for Travelers, and I'm happy to welcome you to our special Citizen Travelers at the Travelers Institute program this afternoon. Citizen Travelers is our aggressively nonpartisan initiative to empower travelers' employees to take part in the civic life of their communities. Underpinning all of the work that we do every day is a representative democracy with resilient public institutions and an economic system that is governed by the rule of law. These are important factors for any business and ones that we cannot take for granted. Democracy depends on informed and engaged citizens, and it's with this in mind that we're pleased to host these series of programs examining civic engagement. We hope you will continue to join us throughout the year and hear how we, as business leaders, can preserve and strengthen our democratic systems. Before we begin, I'd like to share a disclaimer about today's program. I'd also like to invite you to submit questions now and throughout the program. Drop your questions in the Q&A feature at the bottom of your screen. With that, I'm thrilled to be joined today by two amazing guests. Ellen Gustafson is the executive director and co-founder of We the Veterans and Military Families, a nonpartisan, nonprofit organization that empowers more than 17 million veterans and military families living in the United States to help build a more perfect union. The call to build a more perfect union comes, of course, from the preamble to our Constitution and animates both what Ellen's organization does and what our goal is with Citizen Travelers. Ellen is a proud Navy spouse and Navy and Coast Guard granddaughter. Beyond her work with We the Veterans and Military Families, Ellen is also co-founder of the Military Family Building Coalition, supporting active duty military. She is also an author, has been a Fortune Most Powerful Woman entrepreneur, and has given 4 TED Talks. She lives with her husband and 3 young children in Virginia Beach, Virginia. Next, I'd like to introduce Cory Johnson. Cory Johnson is a military and veteran co-chair of the Travelers Military Veterans and Allies Diversity Network, as well as chairperson of his local Board of Education. Cory served in the U.S. Army and Army National Guard for 14 years as a military intelligence officer. He deployed to Afghanistan for 13 months in 2007 with the 82nd Airborne Division. He is also a proud military spouse and supporter. In November 2023, Cory was re-elected to the Rosemont Apple Valley Eagan School Board, the 3rd largest public school district in Minnesota, with 30,000 students. Cory has been at Travelers for 12 years and is currently a product coach for the BI Business Capabilities Office. We're so excited to have both Cory and Ellen with us today. With that bit of introduction, Ellen, can you kick us off by telling us a bit more about We the Veterans and Military Families and what you hope to accomplish through this organization?
Yes, thank you so much, Janice, for that introduction. And it's incredible to see what Travelers is doing with this space. It is so important for our country, and to see businesses take a leadership position like this is amazing. Obviously, we are at the kickoff of a national big election year, we are trying to be one of the organizations that can talk about civics and things like our elections without any partisanship involved, which is totally possible. So it's really great to see Travelers be able to do that and take a leadership position. So I'm here as a military spouse, as a military family member, to talk about common purpose and to talk about how our veteran and military family population can really be some of the key civic assets and leaders in things that make our country great and in ways that all Americans can work together. So next slide. I'm going to quickly talk about the community of veterans and military family members, which, really often gets thought of as a separate group of people from sort of the general population. There's that civil military divide that people talk about. But we're a pretty big group of Americans. Obviously, the number of active duty service members and veterans, then spouses and adult dependents who we're referring to. There's obviously more children, but in the context of this civics conversation, we're talking about the adult population and then the spouses and adult children of veterans, which really is a really important part of our community. People that have understood service from their time in service and from the experiences of their closest family members. So next slide. The population is incredibly pluralistic. So it's diverse by race and gender, from where people come from, the state, their ethnic background, their religion, And they are not siloed like many of our fellow countrymen in their different, you know, populations. They're not siloed in their workplace. They're forced in many ways to have social interactions across many different areas of the country. And they live, you know, we live in a pluralistic world. And one of the reasons I started this organization was that I realized as a military spouse living in America that I had one of the most sort of diverse social media communities of all my friends. You know, it was not siloed one way or the other in any different set of binaries. And I thought that was incredibly important, but also unfortunately unique in our country. So next slide, just to go through quickly, you know, where are we as a community in terms of civic engagement? A lot of people think of the veteran population as having done our civic engagement when members of the veteran population were in the service, but actually veterans are more likely to vote, they're more likely to volunteer, they're more likely to belong to a civic organization and more likely to donate to charity. So the next slide will show just some data about, you know, veterans versus non-veterans. We're not talking about dramatic shifts, but consistent involvement in civics as a population. So a really important civic asset, as we like to say. And then, of course, if you go to the next slide, there is this culture of service in our families. So we say the military is increasingly a family business because over 70% of currently serving active duty members come from a military family. And of course, since the draft ended 50 years ago, all service members have volunteered to serve. So, you know, it's interesting. We talk about volunteering. You know, you of course do volunteer and then you're paid. So it's one of those sort of words that a lot of times Americans confuse. Yes, you are paid to be in the service. You know, you have a paycheck, but you do have to actively sign up and volunteer to do it. So it's one of those, you know, amazing things that we know our fellow countrymen do, but we also know that our fellow countrymen don't do it in a wide, necessarily the widest population that we could. It tends to be a more narrow population. In the more recent veteran population, there have been different ways that people have found community and purpose. As we know, with some of the sort of modern, what they call post 9/11 VSOs or veteran service organizations, groups like Team Rubicon and Team RWB, and the Mission Continues, those are groups that gather veterans together to work on purposeful projects, whether it's in their own community or disaster relief or athletic engagements. It's really the way to connect veterans back into the community and kind of get that feeling of doing something better than ourselves in the same way that people do when they're on active duty. So next slide. The other thing that's incredible about this population is that the vast majority of Americans across all political backgrounds and spectrums and ages consider the veteran and military family community to be one of trust, to be disciplined, patriotic, loyal. You know, we tend to try to do what's right for the country. We're good role models. I mean, these are really, really high marks for one population that actually makes up a lot of different subpopulations, right? So again, pluralistic, but also really rated as trustworthy. A reminder that America can come together and see all different types of people as being trustworthy and have confidence in them. And so a really important reminder of how America is better when we all work together. So if you go to the next slide about how we are organized, this is something else that's really interesting about our population. We have certainly many veteran organizations, but if you think of even your own company, we are a highly organized group. We have a veterans, you know, subgroup in many big companies. We have these, you know, sort of known big veterans organizations, military family organizations. We have the VA, where, you know, half of this big population is connected for its healthcare. And then we have our own kind of case study, which I'll share a little bit about in the future. You know, we're a highly well-networked group. We are, you know, very involved in politics. We are very involved in community service. And so we are a great way to access a lot of America through a relatively small number of organizations. So if you go to the next slide, We took this as a relatively new organization to be an opportunity for our democracy. Look, again, we're respected, we're trusted, we're pluralistic, we're already civically engaged, and we're spread all across the country. So if you go to the next slide, our core mission as an organization is that right now there is a sense of sort of, you know, fraying of our social fabric and a loss of trust across many different populations. We believe that this community, the veteran and military family VMF community, getting engaged and getting more visible in our work for our democracy and for and in civics actually creates a positive cycle that will kind of push back to the country in many ways that's very, very needed. Trust in our democracy, trust in our institutions, strengthening the foundations of what makes our country work. And, you know, we need all of these sort of bureaucratic institutions spread across different areas of our life to make the country work. And we believe that the more visible veterans and military family members can be in those institutions, the more trustworthy they'll be. So next few slides. Like I said, the crossover of our veteran and military family community and civic engagement is where We the Veterans and Military Families was born. So the next slide, just a few more data points. We have a theory of change that if we take sort of a systems approach and a public health approach to the way our democracy works, we can actually make really big change. We use the systems that exist, we use the people that are already there, and we sort of bring those best practices to the forefront. We believe that, you know, that solving complex problems like the rise in violence in our country actually just needs more civic engagement, and solving core challenges that the military family and veteran community deal with, which then, of course, creates a positive cycle for the whole population. You know, we have challenges in the veteran and military family community of job security. Well, you solve that, you solve a lot of other problems in America, right? So we think we are a great model for solving challenges across the country. And we believe strongly that a big tent coalition model and partnerships across many different sectors is the way you get things done in our country. So next slide. Our focus areas as an organization are to increase patriotism and civic engagement, to promote information integrity, to stop the violence that sometimes has spread across our country, and to represent our community well. So next slide. Positive patriotism, keeping people safe from online threats and from online, you know, sort of different information, and to protect information integrity for all people, not to take sides, not to try to make choices for people, but to make sure that we actually can have civil dialogue by coming to the table together. And the key way that we've done that, which is the next slide, is through our Vet the Vote campaign. We established this campaign in 2022. We saw that America needed more poll workers to make our elections work. And we thought, wow, what an opportunity to reach out to this highly organized, pluralistic, you know, across the country population of veterans and military family members and ask them to serve as poll workers. We collected, on the next slide, you'll see a coalition of 40 plus organizations across the military, family, and veteran community, but including civic organizations like the NFL and the Chamber of Commerce. And we gathered these folks together to say, look, let's very directly ask this population to sign up to serve again as poll workers. And of course, the mission was, let's make sure we have enough poll workers to run our elections, but let's remind America that these people who serve as poll workers are serving. And as veterans serving again, we create a really positive sort of view of what a poll worker might be. The amazing news about this program is that in 2022, America needed 120,000 poll workers to fill its need. And in our community, we pushed out, we pushed through the VA and all of these VSOs. We recruited 63,500 veterans and military family members to fill half of America's need in 2022. And so we're really excited to do it again in 2024 and to get big numbers to remind America that when you go vote, you are very likely to see a volunteer helping you, you know, fill out the paperwork and check your ID and do all the things you need, get the right pen. You're very likely to see a veteran or military family member among those volunteers. Next slide. We've also developed a program to try to connect people back to the veterans who are actually working in the news media. And we have a podcast trying to actually educate our population about how our democracy and country work. The irony is people assume that in the veteran and military family population, we know more about how civic works than the general population, but in many ways we don't. So we would like to see that. So next slide is just to say, we would love to invite you know, members of the Travelers military family and veteran community in to Vet the Vote and to keep being the incredible civic assets that you are for our country.
So much, Ellen. I think We the Veterans and Military Families is an amazing organization, and we're so glad to have you here today and to spread the word about it. I can see all these claps coming through the screen, which is amazing. So I couldn't agree more, but we will come back with some more. I'm looking forward to a discussion. In the meantime, I want to turn it over to Cory and have Cory tell us a little bit more about the work he does with the Travelers Military and Veterans Allies Diversity Network, and as well as his role on the school board.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Janice, for the introduction, and also just for welcoming me to be a part of this with another distinguished guest, Ellen. It's just been so great hearing your introduction, Ellen, and the mission that you support with We the Veterans. So hello, everyone. Again, my name is Cory Johnson. I am a co-chair for the Military Veterans and Allies Diversity Network here at Travelers. We are a diversity network at some other organizations. They may refer to different diversity networks. Maybe you have an employee resource group. But we brand that here at Travelers as a diversity network. And what we do is, I really want to call out the allies part of our network too. So we support military veterans, military connected employees, spouses, family members, but also really interesting, 60% or more of our members at Travelers are allies, what we consider maybe not a directly connected military connected employee. However, they join our network to support because they believe in the mission. So our mission really has four prongs that we really look at here at Travelers. We want to develop awareness of military member skills and experiences that may impact the business in unique ways. A lot of military might come after a 20-year career serving in the armed forces and might come to enter the private sector working and may need some assistance both from the military side and also from a hiring manager side, deciphering what that experience looks like and what that skills that they can bring then into the private sector. Next slide. We also promote military and veteran-friendly policies at Travelers that recognize the unique sacrifices of current military members and their families. There are a lot of laws that protect National Guard and reservists, but there's also a lot of things that organizations can do to help them and support them even more. We're always looking for ways that we can go above and beyond to support our military connected employees and how we can work to achieve that. Next slide, please. We also provide support for our military and veteran employees and their families. And last one, to manage and participate in outreach events within local communities. Running a military veterans and allies diversity network is amazing. And one thing that always touches me is how much our members want to continue to give back to the community. So one thing that we do as a diversity network is then find out how we can take our membership in order to help veterans and military-connected families in the community. One other thing I really want to call out is our support of military spouses. So military spouses are sometimes faced with a very unique challenge, right? A lot of times these are spouses that are following their partner on active duty. Sometimes when you're on active duty, you move a lot more frequently. And there's a lot of times that spouses put their own personal career on hold in order to tend to their family. Sometimes we say that military spouses serve just as much, if not more, than their military counterpart. Next slide, please. So a couple of things that we've done at Travelers in order to recognize that is that we really like to invest in military spouses and find opportunities where they don't have to put their career on hold. Maybe we can offer them some sort of remote work or arrangement in order to further their career while they're still supporting their partner. So I'm happy to say that since 2020, when we really started finding ways to support specific military spouses, we have now hired over 185 military spouses across 60 different locations, and many of those are active duty locations. So that's just a little bit about the Military Veterans and Allies Diversity Network. But Janice, you also asked me to talk about my civic engagement. So when I'm not here at Travelers, working in our business insurance office, as co-chair for the Military Veterans and Allies Diversity Network, I also chair my local school board. So I'm the chairperson for Rosemont Apple Valley Eagan Public Schools. I am now in my fifth year of service on that school board. I just ran for re-election this past November and was re-elected for another 4 years. Your term. As chairperson, one of my duties is overseeing the superintendent, representing the public and the community back to the school district, setting policies, budget oversights, and just about everything you can think about in between. There's always something new going on. Our district is actually the third largest school district in Minnesota. That's out of 331 school districts we have. We're the third largest. We serve almost 30,000 students now, and we continue to grow. We've also seen birth rates across Minnesota and really countrywide sometimes go down in certain pockets. Our school district is not just remaining flat, but it's still growing a little bit. So we're planning, we continue to plan for the next evolution of kindergartners about to hit our schools and supporting them all the way through graduation.
Thanks so much, Cory. That's great. I think that's a great segue into our next conversation and our discussion. And I just want to remind people to put questions in the chat. We'll hope to get to them at the end. But, you know, both Ellen and Cory, I think you touched on this in your opening remarks about, you know, why are veterans and military leaders uniquely positioned to be leaders in the civic space? And what makes them, you know, particularly effective in that role? Ellen, you want to kick that off?
Yeah, well, first of all, I want to say it is so awesome to see what you guys are doing for military spouses, because, you know, it's amazing. I've been married to the Navy for 12 years, and it absolutely has affected, you know, my career, my friends' careers. You know, it's amazing how all of a sudden I realized this is the most important thing in my life. I should probably be working in this community, so which is hence why I'm running an organization in this space. But you know, I think, you know, look, like I was saying with some of the data, which I think is important for people to understand, we're a really actually very diverse community, but we have this common bond, and the common bond happens to be patriotism, you know? And so I just think that's it's such a rarity now, which is awful. And we're actively working to try to overcome that. But to have a group of people that actually our common bond is not just our citizenship, is not just, you know, the soil on which we live. It's actually that we have committed to do something to make our country better. And there's just something really powerful about that and sort of, you know, remembering that and saying, look, it's not just because we might have gone off and had to do a difficult deployment together. It's actually that, you know, we had this core mission that happens to be fundamentally about our love of country. And again, we've got to find ways to make that a little bit more common and that we can teach the rest of the country what it means to feel that way.
Yeah, you can really be a beacon or a leader in that regard. It's very inspiring. Cory?
Yeah, I completely agree, Ellen. And I would just say, you know, a lot of people join the armed forces. They join the military for a variety of different reasons, right? Some have this innate service to defend their country and to serve their country. Some maybe are following a friend that maybe is joining. Some maybe just are looking for an avenue to pay for their post-secondary education, and that military recruiter calls them up, and that sounds very tempting, right? Those GI Bill benefits. So there's a lot of different reasons of why people join the military. However, what I can say is what's amazing about the armed forces is that regardless of why you decide to enlist or go through ROTC or OCS, regardless of the reason why you actually join the armed forces, the military does a really good job of have kind of baselining everyone when you're going through training together, right? They instill this sense of patriotism for you. They instill the sense of country, defending your country, and really a brotherhood and sisterhood with your the men and women that are standing by your side defending your country, that trust that you give to them. So when, regardless of the reason why you join the military, when you're done, you're always going to have this innate sense of patriotism and ways and still wanting to give back. That's actually one of the reasons I joined my local school board. I got out of my 14-year career in the military, and I still had a need to give back. And I was reflecting on my service and what I've done over my career. How can I give that back? And my response to myself was really, well, in the educational space, how can I give back there? So similar, I think no matter why you join, you leave with a sense of purpose, of patriotism, and still this need to continue to serve your community, even when you're done serving in the armed forces.
Makes perfect sense. I think that actually was our next question, was really, you know, how did your military service inspire you to become more involved in your community? I think you hit that already, Cory. Ellen, I wonder if there's anything else you want to say about that.
Well, yeah, you know, the real story here, I mean, I've worked in sort of the nonprofit space, and I've done different things with sort of social driven, cause driven work. But actually, it was COVID for me, and my husband was deployed. He deployed in February before lockdown started, and I had 2 1-year-olds who are twins and a not yet 3-year-old, and I was surviving with that situation and a deployed husband. And my best assets were my fellow military spouses, many of whom I had on paper nothing in common with. We were not from the same kind of places. We didn't have the same backgrounds. We didn't even have the same family structures. We didn't have the same politics. We didn't have the same, but they got me through. I mean, we whether it was, dropping food off at each other's houses or just, I mean, and I realized that, look, everyone went through COVID in crazy survival ways. But to see that I was part of a community that wasn't, I didn't just go back to my family. I didn't just go back to my, college friends or whatever. I went to this group of people that the thing we have in common is this military service experience and that our husbands were deployed together, and that is so cool in this incredibly, toxic environment that many of us live in with, if we disagree about one thing there, all of a sudden everything explodes, to have that sense of what we can really do for each other, regardless of how similar we are, just really inspired me. And that is what made me want to start this organization. Nothing negative, actually, something totally positive, that what a possibility, what else could happen if this community got together in the way that my little small unit did.
I think that's such a powerful message and such a powerful model, because I think part of what we think about at Citizen Travelers is you focus on the positive, right? Like and that's what you're doing, what unites us versus what divides us. And so much of what it goes on, I think, today, and what people are feeling a little anxious about, is that the focus is on what divides us rather than what unites us. And so I think the model for civic engagement is when you get out into your community and you're working with people that you might not always or otherwise cross paths with, you find the common theme, you find the common bond, and you humanize each other and you learn kind of, hey, I actually really like this person that I never would have met otherwise. And so that's why civic engagement can be so powerful. And I think that, what you just described is a really great model for it. So amazing. So I think, we're kind of, the next question I have, but I think these all kind of run together, is how can strengthening civic engagement and informed citizenry among active duty members help our communities as they carry these lessons into their post-military life? So I think one of the things we always find with these webinars is kind of active examples of what people can do and how that this can make a difference, like action items, so to speak. I wondered if you could speak to that.
Yeah, I'll jump in first, Cory.
Please go ahead.
Yeah. So I think, look, I mean, like I was saying, there's so many reasons, unfortunately, because of things like social media, that can cause people to say, well, we're at war. I mean, there's a sense of that, but I think, people's experience on active duty will have cross-cultural dynamics. I mean, it just will. And so, the ability to say, okay, I had this experience. I know that I can work well with people from different backgrounds, and really trying to find how we can help service members as they transition, use that as one of their core value propositions as they move into the rest of their lives, is one of the more hopeful things. I mean, a lot of narratives about people in the military and people who get out of the military are really negative. And we don't elevate this incredibly positive experience people have, almost speaking a foreign language, right? Like the ability to work in cross-cultural environments is a language that a lot of Americans unfortunately don't have. But service members do, and spouses do, because we live in this world. We know, look, you could be born in one state and you are definitely not going to live there if you're going to serve in the military for a certain period of time. So that's one thing. But I also think, we really have an opportunity as a community of military members to utilize and take seriously the trust that people have in us. And I think, if we as an organization, we feel really strongly that, look, when people are looking at you, and it's not just in person, but it's also online, and therefore your voice is a little bit louder than other people's, you have a real moral responsibility for that. And I think that's something that we hope to instill in the community of military members, plus the community of veterans, to say, we're not trying to tell you what to think or what not to think, but that people are watching you, and the trust in you is fragile. And America may not always trust, you know, members of the military and veterans, but it's really up to us to try to maintain that and strengthen that going forward. You know, there was a time when it was almost impossible to be elected into elected office in this country if you had not served. You know, of course, that was a time when mostly men were being elected, and there's a lot of other challenges with that. But you know, there's a value there, and that value could slip away. So there is there's a real, you know, it's on us to sort of maintain that. And I think focusing on the positive patriotism, the civic assets that this community is, will really help to maintain that. But it's also a little bit of self-policing, you know, that, you know, if people are looking at you, you know, we're given some minimal training as military family members to not share national security information. You know, don't share the exact date that the aircraft carrier is going to get back to port, right? Because that's public information that maybe the government doesn't want, you know, everyone to share. But it's actually that, from that perspective, that we can really have a little bit elevated sense of our voice and our positioning in the public sphere and what responsibility that carries for us.
Yeah, I completely agree with everything you said, Ellen. I loved it. So, and I really love what you talked about like that that moral obligation that military veterans and connected employees might have about how, you know, people are watching you to set an example, whether you know it or not. So Janice, you asked a little bit about how can the military think about strengthening that. I'd say part of it is letting them know and making it very apparent that you're setting an example, because some military members might not even realize that their words carry weight because of their service to their country. So I think actually educating them about how that's perceived can be a huge asset, just so that they realize, like, people are looking to what you say, and they're looking at you to set an example. Whether you're in or whether you're getting out of the military, and whether you're stepping into maybe a civic service type of position, because of that trust that you are almost innately given just because of your service history. The other thing I'd add a little bit is, and Ellen, you touched on this just a tiny bit too, one of those reasons that sometimes I feel like military members can be really, really great in their community after service is because of this. When you get in the military, whatever branch, you're thrown in with people all in all ways, shapes, forms, sizes, from different backgrounds across the country, you know, different family structure dynamics, diversity, income levels, right? All together. And you're just thrown together and say, oh, your team, now figure out how to work together, right? And it takes a long time to figure out how to work together and to figure out how to have those conversations when you're around a lot of people that don't look, sound, act, or anything like you, but it's the same for every single person around. And why I say that that's an asset is because, Ellen, you also alluded to some of the struggles we're going through right now as a country with some disagreement and things like that. I found being on the school board, I am constantly speaking with people that have different ideas, that have different thoughts and suggestions. And I can tell you, sometimes when I hear any sort of discomfort in that voice, being able to sit down and have that conversation with the person is how we get over it, right? It's not, you know, stating your facts on social media and then having the other person state theirs. That doesn't go anywhere ever. But when I can get on the phone and have that conversation with them and say, I want to hear what you have to say, and then have you thought about this, and talking about different viewpoints and coming to consensus, at the end of the day, you might still not agree, and that's okay. No one's saying we have to agree on everything, right? But I think it's important to be open to different viewpoints and hear those people out in those different viewpoints. And that's how at least you can agree to disagree and move forward, at least being able to say you feel you were heard. And that's why sometimes I think about those skills that you learn in the military, being able to listen and talk with people regardless of their background, can really be an asset then when you're moving into a civic engagement role, because it gives you those tools to be able to have those conversations with people that might not think exactly like you, but still need to be heard.
Yeah, I think that's exactly, you know, one of the things we talk about at Citizen Travelers is this virtuous cycle, right? So there's skills that we learn at Travelers: innovation, leadership, collaboration, working as a team. And those are skills that make you a great civic leader. And you bring those skills out into the community. And then in turn, you learn, you meet a diverse group of people, you learn different perspectives, you learn new skills in that civic role. bring those back to travelers, so travelers win. So I think it sounds like that's exactly what you're saying, in the sense of the things that you learn, you know, through military service or as a military spouse, are really great skills to bring out into the community as a civic leader. And then, you know, it's the cycle continues. Are there any, like, you know, are there any specific examples you have of, like, on your time in the school board where you said, like, wow, like, this is exactly, you know, this is something I learned in the military that I am applying here? Or,
oh, I have so many examples. I'd say, you know, I have so many examples. Here's a very extreme example, but I'll give it because we've all lived through it and we've already mentioned it, right? Being on a school bid during COVID, when nobody knew what was going on, right? So I was elected to the school board. I was elected in November of 2019. I assumed office in January of 2020. Within my first 90 days, I was being asked to close 37 schools to almost 30,000 students. And what? How do we do that, right? And I think everyone remembers that time, right? What do you do? How do you navigate that? Well, it's tough. It's tough. There's a lot of years that was really tough navigating, and there were a lot of really tough decisions we had to make. But I'll answer it with two things. One thing that the military, that I relied on my military service and background quite a bit during that time for really was being able and being comfortable making decisions even when I didn't have all the information available, because a decision had to be made by a certain time, right? And that can be very difficult, right? Making decisions in ambiguity, that is a difficult thing to be comfortable with. And there are a lot of times when I was uncomfortable with the decision, and I'll be transparent, maybe some of the decisions I made with hindsight, maybe wasn't the right decision looking back on it. However, I was comfortable knowing that the decision I made at the time was the best decision, knowing with the available information I had. And that's a skill 100% the military taught me. And a lot of times in civic engagement and civic leadership specifically, you're going to be asked to make a lot of different decisions, and you need to be comfortable with those decisions and know that decision might need to be made at a certain time, even if you don't have all the information. And then the other example I give is that, again, during COVID and during a lot of other times, right, there were a lot of opinions out there, right? And there was a lot of very strong emotion behind those opinions. And I tell people, of course there should be, right? Especially when I talk about, we're talking about people's children, right? I engage in the educational space. These are K through 12, pre-K, and even some post 18-year-old postgraduate support. But these are all people's children. Of course you're going to have strong emotions. You feel when you feel like you're doing the right thing for your kids, right? But what I would do is I just go back to the same skills I just was talking about earlier, is being able to get on the phone and have a conversation and hear that and practice skills like empathy, which the military teaches you how to have empathy for people, right? Being able to practice those skills by listening, hearing them out, and then talking about issues versus necessarily focusing on the emotion, but talking through that really helps de-escalate situations, help people know that we're all working for the same outcome. Every single person wants what's best for our kids, and we're just trying to navigate the best way to do that. So those, just, I would say both those, the comfortableness with making decisions in ambiguity and being able to practice skills like empathy by having conversations in order to get to the proper outcome that we're all trying to achieve together.
Yeah. I'm sold on the skills that in the military, as a military spouse, that translate into civic engagement for sure. And Ellen, I'm sure you have, you know, many examples in addition to the ones you've already shared. One other thing I wondered if you could touch on as well is, you know, one of the things that I found very interesting when we had a conversation before the webinar was that you said, you know, sometimes there's common assumptions that veterans and military families have kind of this heightened civic knowledge, or somehow are, you know, in some way kind of experts when it comes to civics in some way due to their military service. And I think one of the things we talked upon is that's not necessarily always true. You may have many other skills you're learning, but it's not that, you know, that might not always be the case. And how do we, you know, did I interpret that right? And how do we kind of elevate the civics knowledge?
Yeah, it's so true. And I say this, and I mean, I say this around veterans and military family members and active duty military all the time. people assume, since you swore an oath to defend the Constitution, if you're a, you know, a veteran or military member, or if you married into the military, that somehow you got like that civics 101 government, read the whole Constitution, know what all the three branches do, know what all the different agencies do, and you're the expert. And like, you don't, you know, you don't. They will cut your hair, but they do not necessarily give you a baseline civics course about how our government works or what our Constitution actually says. And that is something that we have to be honest about as a community, because people give us credit for knowing. And so you hear people all the time on all different sides of every political issue acting as though they have a very specific expertise about how our government works, just because they were in the military. And now you have an expertise in certain civic skills, but it doesn't mean you have an expertise in actually how our government works, right? Or how our elections work, or how our, or what every little detail of the Constitution and every amendment says. No, you could study that on your own. I'm not saying people don't, but I think that misplaced sort of credit just about that information, not about the skills, but about the information, it has been dangerous, you know, over the years of our country in different ways. I mean, there's different historical examples of that. But I think what's an opportunity is to say, should we be then? Like, should we try to know more? Because if we're going to be given credit for it, should we? And we've, as an organization, thought a lot about that. How can you help people, you know, learn more? We did a really funny thing as an organization. We started this podcast. The first episode we did was we actually gave ourselves, the leaders of the organization, we gave ourselves the citizenship test. Because, you know, you're born into this country, you do not have to take a citizenship test. So you actually might not know the answers. We did not get 100%. Like, every one of us, even people who are retired military, retired Marine Corps, you know, we did not get, none of us got 100%. We were close, but, you know, we all passed. But I think that was, you know, it was our humility to say, look, we're pretty educated people and we've been around this community. We still don't know some of the intricacies of our different branches of government and how many representatives and how many, this, like, that's content that you don't necessarily learn. You learn skills, but that's different. And I think, you know, one of the things though that I think is actually really cool that we do learn is this much deeper sense of the differences of different parts of America. In other words, the South, the North, the East, the West, the Midwest, the subtleties, the coastal areas. And I think an amazing skill is the ability to sort of bloom where you're planted and see what's best in all these different areas of the country. You know, I lived in New York City for many years. Then I spent 6 years in San Diego, and now I've spent 6 years in Virginia Beach, Virginia. Two places I never in a million years would have thought I would have lived when I was, you know, living in New York City as a young person. But incredible places to live. And I love both of these places so much more. I have found so much more culture and things to love about these places. And I would never have had that benefit as a citizen of this country without the military sort of pulling me to them. So that's content that we do know.
Cory, I don't know if you have anything you wanted to add to that or...
I you know what? I'd love to, but honestly, Ellen, you covered everything I had. That was awesome.
That's great. I think, I think that's one thing that I've learned in engaging with citizen travelers too, is that, you know, there's always more to learn about from a civics perspective to be a more informed citizen and just to be able to kind of filter through all the information that is out there. It's great to have kind of a baseline of nonpartisan knowledge so that you can kind of evaluate things in your own right. And so that's one of the goals we have for citizen travelers as well.
I will say, after this webinar, I'm going to go on and take that citizenship test. Now I'm kind of curious how I do.
It's so fun. It's also humbling. You're like, oh, wow, yikes. You know, here you thought you're like this really smart person. Yeah.
That makes sense. I think we should all do that. I want to leave enough time. I'm just scanning through the questions. I want to make sure that we leave enough time to get to some of the audience questions. And one of the first ones that came up, it's from Michelle in California. She said, if people are divided on politics, unclear on constitutional rights, et cetera, how can we get people to engage or even respond to civic calls for more civic engagement in the community? I wondered if you could share your thoughts on that.
Yeah,
Go ahead, Ellen.
Oh, go ahead. Go for it. You go.
I was just gonna say, and I'll be a little brief here, but I'd say it's twofold. I think when I see these very polarized opinions, there's two things happening, right? There's one person has a truth that they know is the truth, and they're talking with another person that also has their truth that they know is the truth. And then when they come together, they can't, you know, it's very difficult to have a discussion when you're already grounded in the same truth. So when you ask like what you can do, right? The first thing I'd say is that when you go in, because the number one, I already talked about it, it's the importance of having the conversation, right? But I'd also say, you can't go into the conversation knowing you have all the answers. Even if you think you're 100% correct and you've been living this way for so long, I think at the end of the day, you still have to acknowledge that another person has a very strong point of view for a very specific reason. And let's have that conversation and develop that empathy for that view so that then we can start to work towards it. If everyone comes and approaches every very difficult conversation from the base that they know that they're right, all that's going to happen is you're going to get more polarized, right? So I always say, approach these situations from the viewpoint that you might not have all the answers, right? That will sometimes put you then on the level to be able to actually engage with that conversation. And when the person you're talking with realizes that you're open to hearing their viewpoint, really soon they get open to hearing your viewpoint as well. And that's how you move forward and stop. Maybe at the end of the day, you're not totally in sync, but instead of getting more polarized, you're now starting to come together and talk through your issues.
Great advice.
Yeah. And I would add that what I've found, you know, living this life as a military spouse, especially in really polarized times, is that everything that I've heard an American in good faith say, I mean, and this is like the vast majority of Americans are people in good faith talking about these issues. Everything that different people have said has a little kernel of truth in it, right? So, you know, there's, when we talk about things like this, the buzzwords of misinformation and fake news, like all of these different things actually are grounded in some facts. And then it's, you know, somehow things get muddied. And the other thing is that every mainstream media source, whether it's on the left or on the right, or it's a, you know, newspaper, not necessarily a website, but it has fact articles, news articles, and opinion articles. And I think we've lost a little bit of the ability to say, you know, you could read a lot of different news sources and only read opinion and literally not really know what's going on in any which way. You could read a lot of different news sources that are all on the different sides of the spectrum and just kind of read the news stories, not the opinion stories, and actually come away with a fairly balanced sense of what's going on. There's a great website that we recommend to people called Ad Fontes, Adfontes, like Fontes, like, and it's a bias analysis site. And it shows all biases. Like it's not, we're not talking about one side or the other, but it's a really great tool to use when you're talking to people to say, hey, look, I saw this piece of media on this site. This is biased this way. And you're maybe talking about another piece of media you saw on this site. This is biased this way. So somewhere in the middle of these two is probably the right answer. And it doesn't mean I'm totally right. It doesn't mean you're totally wrong. It just means that, you know, there's a kernel of truth of what you're saying. There's a kernel of truth of what I'm saying. And we've got to find a way to meet somewhere and you know, and get to something that actually we can agree on as some ground, you know, ground rules. So I those are just some very specific tactics that I've kind of seen over the years.
Yeah, I like that. I think there's another site that it's called All Sides, and it'll show a news story, and it has, you know, the same news story reported by, you know, left, right, and center, and how it's reported differently. And it's just interesting sometimes to be able to look at, you know, a lot of the, you know, several different perspectives on the same, you know, event and see how they're coming across differently. Because I think what we've talked about, what we've hit on today, and maybe not use this word, is this idea that sometimes people are in kind of an echo chamber, right? And so they're yeah. going, oh, yeah. you know, they're around people that see things similarly to do they do, and they're reading news sources that reinforce kind of the same idea, and that contributes to the polarization because you're not kind of getting into this conversation with someone who's offering the other side. And I think, you know, what you said about being in the military is that can't, you know, that just doesn't happen because everybody, you know, it's really a population that cuts across many different perspectives and experiences. And so how do we mirror that in our everyday lives? And I think we're, you know, coming up with some good ideas for that. Civic engagement is a really great one. Obviously, I'm a fan, but yeah, exactly. So my own bias. I'm a civic bias for civic engagement.
It's a good one.
So I think another question I have, and we touched on this a little bit, but I think it's an interesting one. Mark from Illinois asks, how can we help change negative perceptions about the various branches of military service? I think we've talked a lot about how positive the perceptions are of the military are today. And I wonder if you can just touch on that since the questions have come in. Yeah.
So this is what's so interesting. We're living in a time when people still have this like high level of trust of people who are veterans. And yet people talk about how veteran suicide and mental health challenges and homelessness and a lot of people on one side of the aisle, there's this crazy, Rand did this incredible report that there's a group of people who think the military is way too woke. And there's that sort of population. And there's another group of people that think that the military is all a bunch of like, you know, far right extremists. And so like, obviously both of those can't be right at the same time. But the fact is, the fact that those two very strong perspectives exist, and the fact that there's a lot of negative media about a damaged veteran, mean that there's a pretty significant portion of people that are seeing a really negative view of the military. I'll tell you a funny story. I was watching, and my husband was watching a couple episodes of me, and of course there was early in the scene, all of a sudden has the like terrible flashback from his time in the service. And my husband got so mad. He's like, now we have another veteran on a popular show that is like damaged with PTSD. And I'm not saying it's not serious and it doesn't exist. It does. It is serious. But every character being a veteran, having this like one universal affliction, is not good for our country. And it's certainly not good for military recruiting, because now you have a whole bunch of parents who don't want their kids to join because they think this is the only possible outcome. So, I mean, I think, you know, look, we as a country have to have some level setting about the military is not a monolith. The experience of a veteran is not monolithic. The person who joins the military is not all one kind of person. And the more that we are open about that and that we remind America that people look very different and can all be, you know, in this one community, the more we actually open the door to recruiting and sort of this more universal sense of who these folks are. And then I think, look, that's why one of the reasons that we run this organization is to sort of bring that visual of what incredible work veterans and military family members can do as to people's doorstep as much as we can, right? And I'm not saying we're the only ones who can do that, but there's a lot of America who can feel like they're part of a military family, even from their grandfather. And the more we bring those people to a sense of duty and purpose because of that connection, no matter how tenuous, the more we normalize it. And then hopefully it'll increase recruiting numbers and it'll increase the breadth of people who serve and the ways that you can serve. And, you know, people join AmeriCorps, you don't have to join the military, you know? So I'm so glad you asked that question, because we have to have some real talk about, you know, people's perceptions.
Yeah. I'm so glad you mentioned that, Ellen, too, because to your point, veterans aren't one thing, right? And veteran suicide and PTSD is a real issue happening right now. And sometimes we like, when we hear enough about real issues, and by the way, it is a real issue, and there's a lot of programs at the VA trying to help this. But when we as a community hear about so many issues, we tend to attribute that is the whole perception of this community, right? But you can be a post 9/11 era veteran who has PTSD, who still goes to work every day and doesn't have, you know, serious flashbacks, or maybe doesn't need severe interventions, right? You can be suffering from depression and still be getting mental health support that allows you to function, right? So, but if we go and take that stigma, that's all we're hearing, and all of a sudden we create this bias, and every time we meet someone in the military, we go like, oh, are you okay, right? That's not going to help military connected employees as a whole. It's not going to help recruitment numbers like you said, right? I think to your point, I think what we really have to do is just recognize that you can be a lot of different things at the same time. You can be unwell some days and really well and able to contribute another day, right? And that's okay from a mental health standpoint. We want to get people the support they need. You can be incredibly civically minded and engaged and want to contribute to the community and also go to your local VA for care, right? That's okay. And you have to understand that, again, we're not just one thing, right? But we can work at some of the challenges that the military community faces and also recognize all the contributions they give as well.
Really, really important. I think we could have a whole nother discussion about that. I think what that leads to another question, and I think, you know, where do people find veterans group to donate time and money to, or other ways to get involved? Like, what's the first step? Ellen, I think we definitely will put information about your organization, a link to your organization. I think that's a really good first place to start. And, you know, any other suggestions on that point?
Yeah, I mean, first of all, thank you. That's really awesome. You know, and hopefully, you know, you'll see us. We're actually launching Vet the Vote 2024 at the Super Bowl, because crazy as it sounds, the Super Bowl is in Las Vegas, and the Nevada primary is the Tuesday before the Super Bowl. So we're going to give some veterans who are serving as poll workers, actually a veteran from Nevada who has for 20 years trained fellow poll workers. We're surprising this guy. I hope he's not on the call, but we're surprising this guy with Super Bowl tickets in a couple of weeks. So, you know, but I think, look, like, no matter what sort of things that you're interested in or passionate about, there are military family and veteran groups, you know, connected to them. You can, you know, throw military spouses a baby shower if their partner's away. You can, you know, donate to schools that have a lot of military kids. There's so many things you do. And then of course there's veteran programs that work with disabled veterans and veteran programs that get veterans leading, you know, physical challenges for people. So I think anything that you're interested in as a person, there's probably a group out there serving the veteran and military family population that's doing that. The other thing is, the more that there is cross-cultural collaboration, I mean, you do it at your company already, but the more that there's, you know, communities where you can say, I didn't know there were so many veterans in my own town. I didn't know there were military families because there's a base not that far away in my own town. And I think that bridging the civil military divide is as important as sort of giving to you know, people in that sort of need help, because I think the othering of the military and the siloing of us as a different community and culture has also hurt our country, and it's definitely hurt military recruiting.
And I just add, in addition to being able to, you know, give and donate, I would just add on top of that, don't be afraid to look at donating your time as well to some of these organizations, especially as we talk about the civic engagement organizations. If you're out there right now thinking, how I love Citizen Travelers, I want to give back, I want to be more civically minded, and you're thinking about, you know, should I do that or not? I would just say, yes, you should, and you can start now. You don't have to run for school board on your first day, right? There are so many opportunities to be able to give back to your community. At school boards, counties, cities, townships, even states, they all have advisory councils where they need input from people that want to donate their time to talk about real issues that can then advise people that have to end up making the decisions. I'm always looking for people to serve on my advisory councils in the school district to help better inform my opinion. And the other thing I'll say about that is, another thing that I see military connected families and also probably just a lot of business minded people who might be listening to this webinar, one thing kind of thing that they all have in common is this kind of also need to want to develop themselves, right? This professional development, be better at their job, be better in life, be better in their community. There's this need to want to, you know, do better and improve yourself. And I can tell you, sometimes I get asked, you know, why would you run for school board again after you had to lead it during COVID? Are you crazy? Right? And you know what I say is, one of my responses is, you know, I do this because, in addition to be able to give back, it helps me grow as a person as well. I get a lot of different experiences serving my community that helps me grow. So for anyone out there who's thinking, like, do I have the time for this? And what do I get out of it? In addition to helping your community, I guarantee you, you'll grow as a person and a community member as well.
Absolutely. I think that we think so much about that at Citizen Travelers. It's just such a win, the virtuous cycle. You learn so much in these roles, and you bring that back to so many you bring that back to your work at Travelers. I can't thank you enough for being here with us today. And I apologize, we didn't have a lot of time to talk about the Vet the Boat initiative and the use of veterans as poll workers, but I hope people on this call will go onto We the Veterans and check out the information and get involved, because it's a great thing to be part of. And thank you very much, Ellen and Cory. I can't thank you enough for being here with us today. And the power of positive patriotism is really amazing.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you so much.
And with that, I think we'll sign off. And I just want to mention, we have two upcoming webinars for the Travelers Institute, three, January 31st, Fit for Success, Unlocking Health and Performance, February 14th, 2024 Economic Outlook with Goldman Sachs, Chief U.S. Economist, and February 28th, Guarding Against Insurance Fraud in the Digital Era. Please tune in, and we hope to see you again soon. Thanks so much.